Hello, everyone. Welcome to Berks Perspectives. Our intrepid leader, Chuck Gallagher, is on assignment, so I'm here joined today by two of the usual suspects, Ruth Martelli.
Thank you.
And Marianne Mahan.
Mary Ellen, though.
Why do I say that? I know that, and then I get
I hope
brain
it's fear.
Blocks.
It's fear of the future topics and it the is, fact that I will disagree.
It is not just fear, it's terrified. I mean, and if you believe that, I'll give you a heck of a deal on the Penn Street Bridge for you. But let's talk about some local stuff to start out. We had the announcement the other day of Berks Vital Signs. There's a very nice website that you all ought to take a look at, berksvitalsigns.com, cleverly named, that gathers together a lot of markers as to where we are as a community. This was done initially a few years ago, and it talks about things of, you know, how many people in the area graduated from high school, how many from college, all those different things. The health of the community in terms of economics, education, transportation, a lot of different things. It was rolled out by the Berks Community Foundation at a breakfast meeting the other day that I was able to attend. And the intent here is to update this as we go. So have you seen any of it?
I just saw Kevin's Facebook post this morning, so no, I have not investigated it. How did you feel at the meeting, since you were the person in the right place at the right time?
Well, it's having been involved in a lot of civic things over the last years, I can't say I saw anything particularly surprising. I think a lot of the issues that we have around here really focus on jobs. That, you know, we've had some significant companies that are no longer here, and we've had some significant companies that still are here, fortunately, but are now owned by somebody else. Mm-hmm. That we don't have the local thing, and therefore we don't have as much of that leadership that comes from the people that have traditionally run those kinds of organizations over the years as they become decentralized from Berks County. And it's about jobs. We have lagged here. I know just anecdotally from being in the real estate business that when I talk to colleagues in surrounding counties, Montgomery, Lancaster, Lehigh are moving at a far faster clip than we are.
Well, I've told you that my concern is that our representation in Washington is very weak. And, you know, walking around money is still around. And what you can put as a rider on a bill to get your community some bucks just doesn't happen for us.
Well, but even if you have the bucks, the question is, who wants the bucks and what are you going to do with it? I thought that having the Vital Signs report was fascinating. It was in the Reading Eagle. I love bar charts. I'm a data nerd. So, you know, all that's great, but, you know, you refer to it as kind of like a health check. So, to me, if you go to the doctor and the doctor tells you that your pulse is 55, okay, that could mean that you're very healthy, or it could mean that you are seriously ill. So, what I'd like to see the data tell in the future is the so what story. And if we want to change something in the community, what is it that we need to change? So, you know, you've jumped to we have decentralized corporate ownership, and we have lots of businesses that have left, which are true. I look at the fact that we have five colleges within a very close, you know, proximity of this city, and are we focusing on specific ways to drive industry into this area to try to bring jobs back in? I mean, you take a look at some of the success that RAC has had, but, you know, RAC's success is more, I'll say, on the blue-collar, vocational, you know, type jobs. You know, I mean, if you want to be a welder in Berks County, you can get out of school and have a job tomorrow, okay? You want to go start a business and go hire 10 employees and try to go get money to subsidize, you know, are we teaching those types of skill sets, and how many new businesses are growing?
Well, that really is one of the things that some of us have debated for years. I mean, there's been a lot of efforts over the years to go land that big one, you know, to get some company to come and put a facility here with 500 or 1,000 jobs. You know, that's neat. But, you know, how about if we take, 10 companies that are already here and get them to add 100 jobs each? You know, we end up in the same place in terms of the number of jobs. And that's where things like RAC can be very, very instrumental in helping to those local companies that are already here to grow bigger.
It's fascinating that within the city limits, there are three institutions of higher learning. We're sitting in a building on one of those campuses here at Albright. But Alvernia has grown by leaps and bounds, and it has had major impact, I think, through its students and its leadership on the city. But I wonder how our, because I didn't look at these bar graphs, and you two know it, so how does our poverty rate compare with those in Lancaster and Lehigh? Do you know? In Montgomery?
I can't cite it accurately. It's not as stark
as you would think.
You might guess.
Yeah.
That all the metropolitan areas have got their share of those issues. And one of the things that the name Berks Vital Signs implies is they're looking at Berks and not just the city. Now, you know, the city, of course, we've got the ongoing argument about whether it's the hub and the wheel or the hole and the donut, you know, so we still have to solve those things. But you mentioned Alvernia growing and stuff. That was in the paper this morning about they're starting some demolition work on some older residences in the area in order to build a large
rec center
that's going to serve the community as well as the college and add classroom space and give them the opportunity to really take another significant step forward. So, I mean, that's exciting stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But we often, you mentioned it, come back to that word leadership. And we had a point in time in this area where we had a bunch of these CEO types, the Sam McCulloughs and Al Boscov and others that really had a strong personality and really led the way on some things. And those folks have either retired or moved on. In Al's case, of course, passed on. But the bottom line is that we've kind of developed a more collaborative sort of leadership in the community where there's different groups doing different things. But I worry that we don't have some unifying force. And frankly, that's where something like a congressional district can play a role, not just in bringing dollars in, but being kind of a central clearinghouse and having some sense of where the heck we all want to go together. Berks has had a reputation, I know up in Harrisburg, so one day somebody comes in asking for something, and a day later somebody else comes in asking for something entirely different, and they get a sense up there sometimes that we don't have our act together.
As a county?
As a region, you know.
Well, and all you have to do, in my opinion, is look at the commissioners. I mean, Mark Scott has been maybe not anti-city, but certainly not sympathetic to the needs of the city. He didn't even want the general services building to be built in town. So if you have people who are ostensibly our leaders who can't agree on what role is to be played by the county seat, then I can see that that could happen. I'll tell you something else that I think would make a huge impact, and you're the champion for this, but I don't know, if I had the money, honest to God, I'd build it myself, is a railroad link to Philadelphia, to Lancaster, to other areas, because people could move here because it's cheaper to live here, et cetera, and we have some gorgeous neighborhoods. And people who might move out of the city aren't too worried about living in another city. That could revive some of the housing stock and what have you, and people could infuse us with some money through shopping, and then you'd bring in restaurants, and you'd bring in shops, and you'd bring in all kinds of things.
Well, thanks for the encouragement there. I mean, I truly believe in the rail service. Now, Lancaster is probably not obtainable. There is no existing line, and buying right-of-way and establishing something is extraordinarily expensive. Whereas the Philadelphia link, it's already there.
Yeah.
And I've kind of shifted my emphasis. We've talked about what's known as a one-seat ride, where you get on in Reading and go all the way to Center City, Philadelphia, without getting off the train. I'm ready to give that one up and say, all right, look, we got to run a diesel car from Reading and Wyomissing down to King of Prussia or so, and then you change trains because it has to be electric from there into Philly because of some tunnels and stuff that you can't run the diesels through anymore. So I think we got to get over that and do it. But the reality is SEPTA was running on the old Reading Railroad up to the mid-80s rail diesel cars. And that line, if anything, today is in better shape than it was back then because of Norfolk Southern's investment in it. So I think it can be done. But we just have to develop the will to get people together. And that's, again, leadership, that we need to bring people together.
Well, let me ask an ignorant question since I was not living here then. why don't we have rail service?
It stopped in 1981 or 82.
Well, it was a combination of America's overall love affair with the automobile. That, I mean, at one point, the Reading Railroad did as much passenger service as they did freight service all over their territory. There were trains that ran continually from Philly to Pottsville and all kinds of other places. So the automobile did its thing. The Reading Railroad went into a bankruptcy thing, was acquired by Conrail. SEPTA picked up the service, but we're actually outside of SEPTA's footprint here. They really only go as far as Pottstown, and it just, ridership fell off because the service wasn't as reliable and frequent as need be, and it was a combination of things.
It has, to some extent, left us isolated because we don't also have the kind of highway systems that make the Lehigh Valley much
more... Well, you're exactly right. Transportation in general has been lacking. I mean, when you drive on the highways, when you come from another county into Berks, what's the first thing you generally see? It's a red light. You know, there's one in Douglasville. You have them up at Long Lane just north of Kutztown. I mean, you run into traffic lights as opposed to a highway that connects things. Now, there's help on the way. I mean, the 222 North is the Chamber of Commerce's biggest transportation priority, and it's now being worked on. There are these roundabout things, which some people are still skeptical about. But again, I think we got to do it in steps because we live in times that money is not as abundant as it ought to be. So, you know, we talk about Washington and being able to get money from them. At this point, they don't have any money. And now, Harrisburg, let's shift gears to talk about the state for a sec. Harrisburg has now finalized their budget months late, and it's on the backs of what some people consider to be bad behavior. We're going to be putting slot machines in taxi cabs and
stuff. It's a Hail Mary pass.
It's going to get worse because, I mean, you've at least every show, you mentioned that, you know, these mandates that are unfunded, you know, are problematic. And today the tax bill was rolled out at the national level. So we have tax cuts that are, I'd say that we have many more unfunded type things that are out there now. So, I mean, because, you know, this budget is based on hope and prayer with trickle-down economics. So there's no guarantee.
But on the other hand, can't the federal government do with some less money for once? I mean, when I had an opportunity many years ago now in the mid-90s to run for Congress, one of the things I used to talk about was, let's empower every department of the federal government to reduce their budgets. We'll say, okay, everybody's got to reduce their budget by 5%. You figure it out. I don't care if you don't buy as many paper clips or if you sell brownies in the lobby. Come up with something to save 10%, you know, 5 or 10%.
Yeah, 5 or 10, but 30% from the State Department.
You've got to start somewhere.
Well, oh no, my goodness, not the State Department.
I would have preferred that they take 5% from everybody, and then they wouldn't have done things like said, okay, so we're just going to go blow up all of the scientific panels for the EPA. I mean, there seem to be some departments that are getting more than their fair share.
But you see, what you just said, and more specifically, but in general, everybody gets worried about something happening to their particular hot button thing. It's just like the incumbency being elected to Congress, where people say they're all bums, they got a 26% approval rating, but my guy's okay. I mean, they get reelected. So, I mean, you're never going to get change in that sense.
But what I started my comment was, going 5% across the board would be, you know, sharing the pain. So I would have preferred that than what appears to be a unjustifiable, irrational approach to gutting of certain departments, which in fact is the opposite of what you just said, but along the same lines. I'm going to make, you know, I being 45, arbitrarily deciding which departments he feels needs to be cut, as opposed to sharing the pain across the board. So I think sharing would have been a more rational approach.
You know, I'm just really concerned by cuts at state, cuts at the EPA, some really dangerous decisions, in my opinion, in the Interior Department, and questionable behavior by almost every part of the cabinet. With men, since they seem to dominate everything, really screwing over the taxpayer. taking private planes here, there, and everywhere, and military transport to take your bride on a honeymoon. Give me a break. Especially when you said before you got elected that I'm going to drain the swamp. Well, guess what? It's gotten deeper and deeper and deeper.
Well, I mean, there's certainly valid points made there. It's a, you know, there's just not enough money to go around. So that gives me a chance to move over to the DoubleTree Hotel.
Greens fees. Now let's cut greens fees for the President of the United States. That might actually really save us a lot of money.
Now here we are having a serious conversation, and we, but the DoubleTree has now is pursuing a tax assessment change. Now this was supposed to be the economic stimulator for downtown and bring all sorts of other things down, but ultimately it's a business, and the business plan is that they feel they're paying an unfair amount of taxes and want an assessment change, which given the economy still not moving as it should, they will probably get. Mm-hmm. And there are more dollars that disappear from the city coffers and the county and the school district. What about that?
Part of me really resents the number of people. Once I hit 70, I started reading the obits a little more carefully. And I'm always cheered by people.
Checking for your name?
No, I knew I wasn't there, but I was always cheered when people...
I take comfort in seeing that people apparently die in alphabetic order. When I get down to the L's, I think, all right, we're moving.
You're not there. But so many obituaries start, formerly of Reading. And I wish I could have a conference call with all those formerly from Reading folks who aren't in the obit section and just say, why did you leave and what could possibly lure you back? And how do we, you know, you talked about these colleges, especially Alverni and I'll say Albright, Kutztown too. I suggested to somebody that the apartment buildings on Hamden Boulevard be turned into condos for graduates, alumni from here, say, because a lot of alumni want to be close to their alma mater. They want to go to concerts. They want to, you know, enjoy those sorts of cultural things. And I think there are people who would live, because that's a nice leafy area, what have you, and again, bring something back to the community. But we're dying because a lot of people make real harsh decisions about living in the city for reasons that really stink.
Well, I think help is on the way. I mean, it looks to me like there's opportunities to move in that direction. Those are things that aren't going to happen quickly, but you know, I mean, you just look at Philadelphia. Philadelphia, there are people moving back into the city from out in the suburbs for those very reasons of the cultural things, the restaurants, and so on. So I think there's hope for that. But one of the most important things is that charge has been large part led by younger people.
Well, I was
going to
say,
we got to, as was alluded to a little bit earlier in the program, that we have to make sure that we find ways to keep younger people here.
And give them some, you know, it's wonderful for us to sit here and philosophize because really none of us is elected to do much of anything other than maybe make dinner now and again, Nick.
You get that point?
But what we need to encourage, I think, is giving some credibility to the younger people who are really going to make or break our future. And when you look at who's in leadership positions across the county and the city, there aren't a lot of young people who are motivated to be involved or else who don't feel as though what they have to offer is valued or sought after. So I think that's another thing that maybe ought to be in a vital sign. How do we get younger people who are here for whatever reason to step up and think about leadership positions and being valued and having their input count?
Interesting.
One
of the problems is that we tend to want to go right to the top. And most municipalities have a whole bunch of committees that do various things, recreation, this and that, which I've always viewed sort of as the farm system or something that you get people involved in a particular niche. And as they become more comfortable with that particular function, begin to get a greater sense of the overall community and then want to move on to, all right, well, now how do we pay for these things? Well, that adds another element to it, and you get talking about taxes and whatnot. So it's
But I think
it's a growth.
But sometimes what happens, Fred, is that you get a system in place, a governmental system at any level, and you start, probably for your own protection, you put on blinders because you think you know the answer. So this is the path you're going to follow. And I don't want to hear from you necessarily. And it blinds people to possibilities that you may not agree with me, but sometimes I do have good ideas, Fred. And it might be wise,
well,
not my idea.
Broken clock, you know. Is
twice a day. But there's something to be said to open it up to new people and new ideas and put connections together and grow in that way. Part of the problem, I think, here is that even though I consider myself to be very, very liberal, I don't have a lot of Latino friends. Some. I have Black friends. Not tons of them.
Do you know what percentage of the Reading population is Hispanic?
Huge. Something like what, 80%?
That's 55.
Well, I would think it's 80. But yeah, 55%. And we were talking about council. Do you want to talk about council and the proposal?
Sure. Go ahead.
Go ahead.
Well, one of the things that has been talked about lately is a question of whether or not the city council should be elected at large, meaning somebody that lives anywhere can vote for any of the candidates, or as it currently is structured with districts. The idea of districts is getting representation of those specific neighborhoods. You know, you could argue, frankly, that who turns out to vote when you get these awful municipal election results of 15 or 20% of the people voting, and those are the ones that are actually registered,
excuse me,
which is a percentage of the overall population. They tend to be dominated by older white folks, mm-hmm. is the reality of,
here we are.
Of who votes. So going to an at-large thing might make it even more difficult to accomplish what you're saying about getting some other representation.
I was saying before the show started that city council, you just said 55% of the population in Reading is Latino. There's been a pretty consistent 13% African-American population in the city for a long, 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 long time. And then whatever else is left is white people. But if you look at who's on council, there are many, many more whites. I don't think there are any African-Americans on council at all.
There are
no.
There's
no, I mean, you could argue that the Black community is the forgotten minority. I mean, there's been a lot of talk about integrating the Hispanic population and so on as the whites continue to head for the suburbs or whatever. But we don't hear an awful lot of advocacy for the Black community, not that I hear.
And I'm not necessarily a fan of saying, let's go put a token fill-in-the-blank on city council.
That's not what I'm suggesting.
No, but I think that it is disproportionately white.
Yes, exactly.
I do not think that the ethnicity of city council accurately represents.
Well, it doesn't. That was my point.
To get registered and get out and vote, which, incidentally, we have coming up around the corner.
Yes, and what I'm terrified it's going to be 15% again.
Well, we're coming up on it next Tuesday. Please, all of you, out there and vote.
Get
it's too late to register
vote.
Now, but you got to get out there and vote.
And if you didn't register and should have, do it now so that when the next one comes around, which will be in May, in the spring sometime,
mm-hmm. in May,
yeah,
that you're able to vote.
It is disheartening, and next year's
going to be an important one. I mean, we have governor and, you know, the state legislature, the entire House, and I guess
well, let's
half
hope
of the
that gerrymandering is ended before we get too far along, because it stinks.
You know what? Even with gerrymandering, when you only have a 15-16% turnout, what that says to me is that 85% of the people that could have voted have either said, I'm too busy.
Or my vote doesn't mean anything.
My vote doesn't count. And personally, I think you've abdicated part of your responsibility as a citizen. And you can't, to me, you have no right to complain about what is going on if, in fact, you do not go out and vote. Which is why I vote all the time, because then being able to complain about the results is so much fun.
Well, we're coming down toward the end of our program. Last week, we neglected to talk about Fats Domino. A real giant in the music business.
Standing on Blueberry Hill.
I think Fats Domino, you could see a direct line of descendants from him to Elvis, to the Beatles. I mean, I put him up at that level. I mean, he was a terrific voice. And seemed to be a really good guy. I mean,
He went out in classic Nolan style with a celebration of his life.
Yeah, is that right?
Mm-hmm.
cool.
They celebrated with a parade.
And he didn't mind being called fats, even when he wasn't probably fat.
Well, what works, works. The World Series, it was a heck of a World Series, really. Went to 7 games, which is just the way it always ought to be. Some really good games, comebacks and stuff in, mixed in there. And a surprise, really, to me at least, the Houston Astros, that used to be in the National League, got moved to the American League, have never been world champions prior to this, and they won. So it's kind of a neat ending to the season.
They were never a contender.
Not much. And help is on the way with the Phillies. I'm telling you, I think the Phillies are going to start to get people's attention again in this coming season.
And the Eagles are doing so well.
My stepson's already looking for Super Bowl tickets for Christmas. We told him to look elsewhere.
Boy, I'll tell you, they won't be cheap. But it's the Eagles are really, and they seem to be taking it seriously. They made a fairly significant acquisition the other day at the trade deadline where they picked up a running back who was all pro, if not last year, the year before. Had over 1,000 yards and stuff, and for him to be added is means they seem to be taking this seriously.
They're still undefeated, aren't they?
No, they have
one loss.
They
but
have
that
one
was
loss
earlier
in the second game of the season.
That was Kansas City.
To Kansas City, which seemed to be leading the charge. They've since lost a couple of times, but that game was competitive. They lost it in the fourth quarter by one touchdown. So
I know we're running out of time, but the football story that I think is going to come down in the next couple of weeks is the Patriots are down to one quarterback. There seems to be a quarterback that is not playing right now that is available. Be absolutely fascinating since Bill Belichick has a history of doing whatever is good for his team and not giving a damn about anything else. If Colin Kaepernick got signed to the New England Patriots.
Now that would drive people wild.
I don't know that the owner would necessarily sit still for that, but we'll see. And you'll notice that we stayed entirely away from Penn State coming up short at the end of the game to Ohio State, which was a heartbreaker for me. But you know, I think the truth is, and Scarsella and the Reading Eagle had it exactly right.
They were just not quite
as good, but they're darn close. And after what they've been through with the scholarships and stuff, it really is still pretty remarkable.
But really, to go from 2-7,
we're going to have to end at that spot.
So, well, we don't have to, but we're going to.
See you soon. Thank you.
Bye.